follow me ask, by a show of hands, has anybody seen the latest AARP, well, the local AARP commercial that's been running? Yes, 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 yes. Okay, good, good. And if you haven't, it's coming on certain channels. But much to our surprise, it actually came out during the Dallas Cowboy football game last Sunday. So we're big, you know. And our movie star just walked in, Gloria Davila, Dr. Gloria Davila. She is one of our volunteers and has been, and she was a brave soldier to actually tape this for us, and it was an all-day event, so we thank her for that. We wanted to see if we could demonstrate this to you, or at least show it to you. Our sound is minimal, but we're going to see what we can do. You want to? Yeah, let's see.
Okay. Can I get the light?
We want, I don't know what it is. I guess we'll just. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kim.
Action.
I'm Gloria of AARP, and I'm here at the mural to paint you a picture of all the real possibilities we're creating right here in our community. Because if you don't think real possibilities in San Antonio, when you think AARP, then you don't know art. We're making our city more livable, hosting our Moving for Grown-Up series, providing AARP tech workshops, and sponsoring local music and dancing festivals. Get to know us at aarp.org/San Antonio.
So that is what, that is our commercial, and AARP, it actually costs a lot of money to produce, and a lot of investment. We even invested in the jingle behind, if y'all noticed the music. It is San Antonio. It is Chente Barrera, a local artist who actually created that jingle for us. And we wanted to make sure that it was local and that it was San Antonio and that it had a mix where people could enjoy. And I hope that you do enjoy it. And hopefully you'll get to hear Chente soon, because he will open up with that jingle for us at some point when we have that event. And you'll hear about it. But before we get started on our the reason why we're here today, I wanted to just take a moment, introduce myself, my colleague, and then our volunteers. Because without our volunteers in any city, AARP can't do its work. I'm Lisa Rodriguez, and I'm the Associate State Director. I work here in San Antonio primarily, but I also have an area in El Paso, or El Paso is an area for me. I really work on outreach and a little bit of advocacy, and what advocacy means that we work a lot on trying to protect Social Security and Medicare, or at least being in the conversation when they're discussing changing any kind of benefits. And then outreach, we really want folks to know what we're doing, and we want folks to feel connected. You get your card in the mail, but you may not, you know, say, okay, well, what am I going to do with this? I mean, it's great for discounts and great for other things, but there's also another value. So we've been trying to do a lot more work here in San Antonio. And I'm proud that AARP is making that commitment. Anyhow, my colleague Joe Sanchez, and Joe's here in the red shirt. Stand up, Joe. Joe, do you want to say a little bit about yourself?
Oh, sure. My name is Joe Sanchez, and I've been with AARP now for about 12 years. And I work with Lisa here in San Antonio, but I've been doing work in Austin for quite a while. I do a lot of advocacy, and what advocacy means is working, like Lisa said, you know, working on the issues that are important, legislative issues, like, you know, she does the federal stuff like Social Security, Medicare issues. Yeah, I've been working at the local level, you know, in Austin at the state level, doing work on issues that are important to you also, issues that deal with long-term care, you know, nursing home issues, you know, how to take care of your family, financial security issues, you know, we did some work, Lisa and I did some work on payday lending along with our volunteers. And you know, you're aware of payday lenders. I mean, they're all over the place and they do serve a purpose, but quite frankly, the money that they take out of the community is a lot more than they put into the community. I mean, they're charging rates over 500% APR, and that's a lot of money. And so people are never able to get out of those payday loans. They borrowed a couple hundred dollars. I had a gentleman call me up. He had borrowed some money for a funeral. And I know funerals are expensive. I thought it was, you know, several thousand dollars, because he'd been paying on it for 3 years already. He had borrowed a couple of hundred dollars, and he was still paying for it, you know, years later. So what Lisa and I did, we worked with the city council here in the community and passed an ordinance that now, you know, limits how many times you can roll over your payday loan and that the money that you're paying into it, 25% of that has to go toward the principal. Because you were, before you were not paying into the principal, you were just paying, you know, interest and fees. You never got to the principal. So, you know, we're doing work in the communities, and so, you know, Lisa and I, along with our volunteer, are able to do this. And of course, we'll talk about this later, but we also have, we always have room for volunteers. We're always looking for good volunteers. You know, if you all, you know, have an inkling of doing some work, you know, in the community or, you know, state level, federal level, let us know, and we'll be happy to get you all signed up.
And even if you just want to have fun, we want you to, because we have a lot of fun activity, which we're also going to tell you more about later on. We also have our executive council member, Julia Castellano-Hoyt, who's with us today. And Julia, do you want to say a little bit about yourself and kind of maybe...
My favorite part of being an AARP volunteer, though, is advocacy. When the Texas legislature is in session in Austin, I will help out the advocacy team in Austin by going and testifying before some of the committees. But I first got started with AARP as a grandparent in our grandparenting program that we had at that time. At that time, Texas had over 45,000 grandparents raising grandchildren. And that really told me a lot, because my husband and I had raised two of our grandsons. So the scope of AARP volunteerism can be everything from advocacy, as Lisa and Joe have told you, the thing that Gloria did, that's kind of like once in a lifetime, but it's a great volunteer role. You can be asked to do any number of things, but I can tell you that it's very, very rewarding. And I wouldn't be in it this long if it weren't rewarding as an individual. You grow, you learn, you meet a lot of people throughout the state. And you try to do things that's going to make life easier for seniors. And that's what I like.
Thank you. And then, I like some applause. And then we also have Dr. Gloria Rodriguez. I'm making her my mother now. Dr. Gloria Davila, who is actually, as you saw in our commercial, but she's more than that. She's actually... She does everything for us. So, Gloria, stand up, say a little bit about yourself, because we have a schedule here. But
two sentences. The reason I got to AARP is my husband, so I hope he tells his story in a couple of minutes. But I've been a volunteer for 5 years after I retired as an educator, and I've enjoyed every minute of it. We, like Julia says, we do everything from signing people up to passing out meals to helping people get up on stage, whatever it is, that's what we do. And of course, one of the things that they asked me to do with this little movie, which was quite an experience in my lifetime, for somebody that's never been on TV before, so it was a little scary. But I really enjoy being an AARP volunteer, and my husband's the one that brought me in. He's been a volunteer for about 22 years, and I knew there was something in AARP that held me that long, so.
Thank you, Gloria. And I'm totally remiss. We have a guest from our team, Kim Loop, who's in the back. And she's very quiet, but she's very helpful because she set us up right now in technology. She's really, really important because she does a lot for us, and particularly around technology. But she also spearheads all our social media. So if you're on social media or you're not, we have to face it. It's a real way of communicating. And Kim is sort of the expert, or is the expert on that. So thank you, Kim, for joining us from Austin. And then we'll go quickly, but I do want to recognize Don Castellano-Hoyt, who is Julia's spouse and a volunteer. And then, of course, our very own Alex, who is probably one of the long time, I mean, he's been with us for, what did you say,
22 years.
And he loves AARP. So we thank you both for always coming and supporting us and supporting your spouses. Okay, so we're gonna get going now. today we're going to talk about what it means for our community to be an age-friendly community. And Julia's going to kick us off with a presentation. It's a kind of a brief presentation, but then we want to do an interactive exercise because we want to hear from you what you think we could do even better, because I think we have a great city, but we can always do things a little better, especially from the perspective of a 50-pluser. So we want to hear from you when it comes to that. And it could be something that benefits someone in your family that's not 50-plus. So just keep that going, and here we go. So Julia, take it away.
I think we have a great. I don't know if we have a mic. Before he left, the mayor passed a signed an agreement with ARP to make San Antonio an age-friendly community. And we're very proud of that because we're only one of the few cities from throughout the country who are now embarking on an effort to make age-friendly communities, and that's age-friendly for everybody. We're entering a time of profound change for how the demographics of this country are going. We are an aging population, and what that means is that you and I might have been born into a family of 8 children, and you don't see that much anymore. So the population is aging as we go. Every day, 10,000 citizens, or boomers, turn 65. And that has great implications with how our society is going in many facets, in housing, in transportation, in medical care, and so on. By the year 2030, gee, that sounds like a long time, but you realize that's only 16 years from now. The United States will have twice as many people over the age of 65 as we have today. That tells us we're going to need more people trained to deal with the older population. And survey after survey is finding that older adults want to remain in their homes. How many of you here feel the same way? And hopefully you'll always be in your home. Great, good for you. You fall into that 86% of adults ages 45 and plus strongly agree with the statement. What I really would like to do is stay in my current residence for as long as possible. When you stop to think about that, there might be some implications in that most houses are not designed to adapt. In fact, American homes have been traditionally designed and built for 35 and younger, the age of 35 and younger. So that has potentially, it could be a problem for those of us wanting to age in place. One of the things that my husband and I did recently, because we're getting up there, is we had our bathroom in our master bedroom converted. We took out the bathtub and put in a walk-in shower, had the door changed to where it opened out rather than in, and made the door wider. And that will enable, if one of us becomes disabled, we can still be in a wheelchair, be taken in. It's the little things, but if you can afford to do that, if you look at your home and you can afford to do that now, that's, you're ahead of the game, okay? Survey after survey not only finds that people want to remain in their homes, they want to stay in the community where they're living now. You like your neighbor and you hope you'll be neighbors forever. And in some communities, that is the case. But we're a transitioning society. The younger guys, the younger, our daughters and sons, our daughter has moved 5 times since she's been married. And I have to add the little caveat, they were in the military, so they had to move. But once they settled down, they got out of the military, they've moved 3 different times. We are still in the same house we bought 40 years ago. They've been through 3 different houses. but us older folks want to stay in our community. So for the past 50 years, unfortunately, the communities have developed around cars and other motor vehicles as our major form of transportation. But what happens when we reach the age of 70, 75, our vision gets a little not as good, our reflexes are not as good, our hearing is not as good, so we have to make adjustments. We may have to stop driving. And if where we live makes it necessary for us to drive, that becomes a problem. And I think Joe takes over from here. So I've kind of set the stage for you.
Thank you, Julia. And as y'all heard, Julia talked about, you know, the importance of being able to stay at home. Well, you know, we want to talk about what a livable community really is. So a livable community, as Julia was saying, is a community that has some of these features. It's got affordable and appropriate housing, supportive community services, adequate mobility options, in which these really facilitate personal independence and the engagement of residents in civic and social life. So you're asking, well, why is AARP creating this age-friendly network? You know, AARP is creating this age-friendly network because it encourages communities, you know, like San Antonio, to prepare for the rapid and aging of the United States population by providing special attention to environmental, economic, and social factors that influence the health and well-being of older San Antonians. You know, this network serves as a catalyst to educate, encourage, promote, and recognize the improvements that make communities more supportive, not only of the older residents, but for all residents as they age. So in order to create this network, we're going to provide cities, towns, and counties with the resources that they need to become more age-friendly by tapping into national and global research models and best practices. So we're going to enhance, you know, the things that we have out there now by doing your work in the community. So what are, you know, there's eight domains of livability. And so these eight domains, basically what you know, it's through the development of this initiative that the World Health Organization has identified these eight domains that support active and healthy aging in the community. You know, as you can see there, outdoor spaces and buildings. This is accessibility to and availability of safe recreational facilities. We've got transportation, safe and affordable models of private and public transportation. Housing, there's a wide range of housing options for older residents aging in place, as Julia said, and other home modification programs. Then we talk about the social participation. This is access to leisure and cultural activities, the opportunities for older residents to participate in social and civic engagement with their peers and younger people. We've got the respect and social inclusion. These are programs to support and promote ethnic and cultural diversity, along with programs to encourage multi-generational interaction and dialogue. So these are all things that we do, you know, here in San Antonio. As you know, we have, you know, we have Fiesta, we have the Institute of Texan Culture, we have so many things, you know, that provide that part of the eight domains. Civic participation and employment. You know, we have the promotion of paid work and volunteer activities for older residents and opportunities to engage in formulation of policies relevant to each one of our lives. We have communication and information. This is promotion of and access to the use of technology to keep older residents connected to their communities and friends and family, both near and far. And of course, you know, we provided some information on tech, that's technology, education, and knowledge. You know, it's important that we make sure that older people are connected, because sometimes they're isolated. So we're providing training on your phones and iPads and everything else that you can keep, you know, in touch with your children, grandchildren, friends, and family. That's pretty much my part. Lisa,
yep, all right.
You're up.
Sir,
you know, being part of the Age Friendly Network, as Juliet mentioned, we were fortunate enough to have Merrick ask for the designation from AARP. First of all, because it really goes hand in hand with the SA 2020 plan. And in there, a lot of those domains Joe spoke about are addressed, but for the most part, realize that it is important to focus on the population that is aging. But being part of this network is really going to help us have access to other cities that are trying to do the same things we're doing. It's going to provide us access to research. Lots of times, for example, if there is a park, because parks and open spaces is a domain, if there is a park in the community, we can't always rely on the city to do everything. There's just not enough tax dollars. We don't want a tax increase. We don't have enough tax dollars. So lots of times, there is a gap. And with that gap, you need to go and approach foundations. And usually, groups do it together, or the city will do that. But in order to do that, you need research. So being part of this network of age-friendly communities will help us get some of that research, especially if we want to speak about the 50-plus population. This will also give us opportunities to partner in the community. For example, Oasis is another 50-plus group. I'm not sure anyone here has ever heard of them, but they're one of our partners. The AAA of San Antonio, the group on aging, they're also one of our partners. And many universities are some of our partners as well. Plus, we have partners with lots of nonprofits and churches. So it's really, really important that this gives us that opportunity that we do partner and that we have some kind of, that something in common, because there's a lot of folks that do care about what happens to the folks once they get a certain age, right? We also can be mentored. In fact, I was in Macon, Georgia, 2 weeks ago, I was shadowing Macon, Georgia, because Macon, Georgia was the first age-friendly community. And what I learned there is that the community came together, they went through the whole process of gathering input, and the community decided together, and it's hard to decide where you're going to start, what you're fixing, or what would be a neat thing to do in San Antonio. We're a lot bigger than Macon, so I'll disclose that. But they were able, because they had been part of the age-friendly network, they were able to garner some research and get some expertise around what a park should look like, and particularly for it to be age-friendly. And because of all that research, together, lots, it was a university, it was the city of Macon, it was the county of Macon, they jointly came together and they were able to leverage $22 million to improve a park that had been in disarray in the downtown area, that everybody could come and enjoy. Maybe not every day, but everybody could come and enjoy. So I was able to see that. And we have a lot of opportunities here in San Antonio, and we've done a lot of great things, so we have to recognize that, and we do. We're just trying to figure out from a perspective of the 50 cluster, what can we do better? Criteria for membership. Well, as we just told you, the mayor needs to ask for that designation, which he did. And actually, we became designated in March, but it was actually announced in June. And the reason being is because our CEO, Barry Vann, at that time of AARP, was going to be in San Antonio for that day, and he wanted to announce with Mayor Castro hand in hand. So that did occur. But just to let you know, we've been working on this for quite some time, and there is a lot of interest. And we know that there's still interest with whoever exists there today at council and Mayor Ivy Taylor. She is very interested in streets and sidewalks and what she calls quality of life issues. That's a good thing. What we're doing right now in this process is we really need to gather information, because that information is really going to be part of the age-friendly plan that we're going to represent to the city. So part of the criteria of being a member is that you're not only, okay, you're a member, great, you can tell everybody you're age-friendly, but what else are you going to need? Well, we're going to write a plan from the perspective of a 50 cluster. And you know, that's anybody from 50 to 200 or 110 or whatever. And we really want to know what is important in San Antonio. Joe went over those eight domains. We can't work on every one of them, but what is a priority for San Antonio? And we know it's going to be different depending on where you're at and who you ask, but we do want to take that time to ask folks to get public input. This is not our plan, this is the plan of the community. This is the member list of some of our members, not all. We actually have 33 cities that are part of this network. And I'm very proud to report, you'll see San Antonio there. Of course, we have other Texas cities that have joined. First, it was Austin, then it was Brownsville, Texas, then it was San Antonio, and most recently, it was Dallas, Texas.
and we have some buzz around the office that Houston's very close. So this is really, municipalities, citizens are really interested, in particular ARP, whether you're a member, you're not a member, there are people who want to figure out how can we have a quality of life. Just because I'm 60 or whatever, or 50, you know, what can we do in our city that's really going to help me live my life to the fullest? And then here, we want you to learn more about this, and we're going to give you some handouts in just a bit. But we'd like you to go, if you don't use a computer, as Joe will announce later, we have some tech classes. We'd like you to start using the computer, but we do have a website that you can go to, www.aarp.org/agefriendly. If you go there, you'll see that they'll mention some of them. What you'll also see is a video with our leader at that time, which was Mayor Gusto, talk about the importance of being an age-friendly city. And then we'll continue to work with others to try to garner that support. And I believe that in this district, you're Villagrán, and it's not Villagrán. I think it's Villagrán. But in this area, and maybe it could be IU, a piece of it. But whoever your council member is, we're out there talking to them. No one yet has said, I'm not interested. Of course, they're not going to say that. There's a lot of power in this room. Not only because you're an ARP member or want to be an ARP member or a prospective ARP member, but because you have experience in the city. And that's really what we want to capture today. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to our volunteer, Dr. Gloria Davila, and she'll be up here to kind of start a conversation that we want to have.
Telling you why I enjoy being an AARP volunteer so much. And that is because, first, my husband, as I told you earlier, he's been a volunteer for what seems forever. But he kept asking me when I retired from being an educator, he kept asking me to become a volunteer with him. And at that time, it was about, 6-7 years ago, I said, oh, I don't want to do that. That's your thing. Not mine. But little by little, I started watching what he was doing and the friends that he was hanging out with, and they were all older people. So I said, well, okay. So I started going with him just as a sidekick. And so when I realized what it was that he was doing, then I said, okay, then I'll become an official volunteer. And then as we started going out, meeting people like you, I think that is the favorite part of what we do for AMP. The other thing is that I don't think I ever realized how much AARP does for senior citizens. You know about the discounts. I think everybody, you know, that is a member already has a card that where you can get discounts all over the place. And initially, I thought that was all it was going to be. But as time has gone by, we've gone out and met hundreds and hundreds of people, like me, Mexicanos, que hablan español, that really care about la vecindad, the community. And so as you can see, look at us. We're all Hispanic, and we're out meeting our people. And AARP, that's what AARP wants to do. So we have been out to the Tejano Conjunto Festival, and my husband and I can't dance anymore, but we still got out there a little bit. But it was so much fun with that. We also have been to the Market Square. We have been to the Palo Alto College Festival. And every time that we go out to an event or a place like that, we have a conversation with people like you. And this thing that this project or this effort that ARP is going through is to find out, to have conversations with you about what is important to you in your community. We talk about age-friendly communities. Well, what the heck is that? That means that we want housing, we want transportation, we want health services that are friendly to you and me and my husband, our age, and maybe even the 50-plus people. Because, you know, they don't think so, but they're going to get to our age pretty soon because time passes by real fast, you know that. So this is why we're here, to explain to you about age-friendly communities, but at the same time, we want to hear what it is that you would want improved in your community. that's what we really want to know. And so when, I'm going to give you a couple of examples of things that people have said to me, but Joe and Lisa are going to script what it is that you're saying, because we want to take back to the powers that be what is important to you. ¿Qué quieren de la vecindad de ustedes? The same thing that I want for me, for my husband, and for our grandkids. We want a community that has the services that we need. So for example, the times that we've been out, I have spoken to people that talk about healthcare services. Now, I don't know if you need to do that, but many people get on the bus and then transfer to another bus, and perhaps transfer to another bus. It takes them all day to go to a hospital or a doctor's office to get to a doctor or to a hospital. And so, is that important to you? I talked to another man who every time it really, really rains very hard, his neighborhood gets flooded. Who's going to help him? Is that an age-friendly neighborhood? No, it's not. So we've also heard about the sidewalks, parks. They want more police protection, more police security. They want sidewalks, get the dogs out of the street, swimming pools. You know, so what is it that you think is going to make your community a better place to live? And that's what AARP is here for. To tell you about all this, to give you information, but at the same time, we want to hear you, because we already know our needs and our issues, but we want to hear from your community. And as Lisa said, what is the name of the councilman from this district?
Villagrán.
And this district, what do you want? Or what would you like to see? So that's why we're here. We're going to pester you a little bit to give us some ideas, because those are the real ideas, the ideas that come from you. Does anybody have a question about what it is that AARP is trying to do in the city of San Antonio? Yes.
I just moved here from Michigan to San Antonio to begin my retirement life here.
Welcome.
Thank you. Number one, I got to give you kudos, because we don't have this back in Michigan.
Yay.
But what we did have is each suburb had like a senior center or senior community, and we would gather there once a month, or we would have a calendar, and something was always active for keeping us busy for the, you know, for the month.
Sure.
Either going on a field trip or out to eat, or, you know, taking the bus rides to the doctors,
sure,
or having doctors and nurses and stuff coming into the community and doing blood pressure check, the foot check, and diabetes check, and all this and that.
It's like Doctors Without Borders.
Yes. Sometimes hairdressers,
really?
Stuff like that. Do you have anything like that in here, like that here?
So the city does have a pretty large
senior
centers, senior community centers. And I do know that Vidas Cisneros is not too far from here, down Military.
You don't?
Okay. Oh, okay.
Where do you live?
Up on 410 and Ray Allison.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, you're closer to 410 and Ray Allison. Yeah. So there is. Every district has a senior center. So could you use the computer? Because if you do, San Antonio Delco, go to services, go to senior services, and you'll get a list, a complete listing.
Okay.
And then there's some jointly ran, or I should say in partnership with WellMed.
Okay.
But it sounds like the District 4 Center would be closer to you.
Okay.
District 4, you want to write that down. And then they'll give it to the address there.
Okay, now another question. I was very active with the blood drive and giving blood. I understand the Red Cross is not Red Cross here. What is it here? Or do they do
blood drives
here?
Yes.
What's it called?
Because
I can't find the blood drive. What is it?
San Antonio Blood Bank.
It's on 510.
They have an office
off of West Avenue somewhere.
Yeah, but they have district offices, and there's one right here in Military by the Brooks City base.
Mm-hmm.
It's right next to Avery's.
Next to Avery's. Okay.
It's in that little shopping area.
Okay.
Because they send me emails all the time.
Okay.
Plus, they have mobile trucks sometimes. sometimes that are out.
So what are they called? Because I've been trying to search.
It's a San Antonio.
Oh, it's a San Antonio.
Yes, they call me all the time.
Blood and tissue center or something.
Yeah, blood and tissue center.
Okay.
I have A plus blood and they need it. I'm supposed to go give today and I didn't.
In fact, if you give this month, you get put into a raffle for sports tickets. And if you give twice between September, August and September, you got a HEB card for $10. Yeah, I'm on their regular mailing list.
Well, thank you for your feedback.
Yeah, that's great. That's a great question. So this is what we want to spur. We want to generate conversations about what you're thinking, what is it that you would like, what makes this community better for you to live, for young people as well as people our age.
What exists already here? What is exists? Your sign says exciting things are happening right here in San Antonio. What are those benefits? What do we have that we can add to that maybe we don't have?
Are you talking about AARP benefits, or are you talking about benefits in the community?
Benefits in the community. I'm fairly new, so this is my first meeting and everything, so I'm really out of.
Right, yeah, that's great.
We're not going to let you go now, you know that.
I'm wondering what is there that we can add to that maybe we don't already have, or, you know, like housing, I think, is a big thing. You know, there's a lot of seniors that need help, like the rails, like that Mabel was talking about, the rails for maybe to hold on, or, you know, because there are a lot of people, older people at home already that really nobody knows about.
Exactly.
And they're having problems, and they don't know where to go. I mean, my neighbor asked me not long ago, says, Linda, I don't know what to do. My husband's getting older, and he's going to have surgery, and, you know, I have no help. I have, you know, this and that. And like you said, you know, she's got to go way across town.
Right.
Thank God she still drives to take her husband to the doctor and stuff, you know. And I was telling her, when I started thinking, I said, So when I got the little note in the mail, I said, I'm going to go see what's going on there.
Right.
You know, so that, you know, she said, I said, well, what you need to do is age-proof your house, just like you do up age.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, try to do something like that. So I don't know if that's anything, you know.
Sure, I'm glad you said that, because we do have a program called Home Fit at AARP, and that is a program, and again, we have yet to really roll it out, but if it's a need, we should take that into consideration, but it's really about whether or not your home is fit for you as you age. So the ramps, the bars, the lighting, it's so much, and you don't even think about it, right? The counters.
We're young, we don't think
about that. Home Fit.
Home Fit?
Home Fit, I'm sorry, H-O-M-E-F-I-T.
F-I-T.
And they provide the ramps.
Well, it's not that they provide them. It's a program about what makes your home fit. So it's really about bringing awareness, but there are resources in the community that maybe assist with that, but it's just a program to really let you know what it is you got to consider as you're preparing a home for someone that may need special accommodation, in particular an older person.
Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering, why don't they make, I know it'd be a lot of money, but a community of, let's say people don't want to live in their home anymore, they want to leave it to a family member, and they like apartments, nice apartments, one or two bedroom apartments, but a nice community, but just for people from 50 on, let's just say. No, besides assisted living. I mean, where they can be more independent.
I'm sorry?
Don't they make much money?
Oh my,
that's the other thing. That's a problem. I think either you have to be a property to get any help, because a lot of us are like in between, we don't make enough, but we're not way at the bottom.
That's right.
And that's, I think, a big problem.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that we have, that I have encountered when talking to people, and especially the senior citizens, is that there is a lot of information on the internet, and access to a computer is key. My husband has just registered for the first time. He's 85. He just registered for the first time to have about 6 classes in computer literacy.
Yay!
Yay! You have to, if you want to be able to just find out information in a moment, then it would probably behoove you to perhaps go to some technology classes. And we, ARP of course, has those. And I think this this lady over here, she wanted to know about where they are and when they are and how to get there. Well, I just took my iPad and I was able to Google it and find out where these workshops are. And so it is that easy. But if you don't, then I think probably calling the City of San Antonio and the county, the Bexar County offices, and see what they can get you. Because you have to start at the very beginning by calling and asking what it is that you want to find out. So if it's not the computer, if you're still not comfortable with a computer, like my husband, I mean, I have to drive him to the computer kicking and screaming because he doesn't want to do it, but it's time that he learns. He depends on me to use the computer, and yet he's a very intelligent man, very hardworking and everything. However, no kidding. Well, yeah, and if you're not comfortable with it at all, that's fine, but check out with us and anywhere about the workshops that we have for technology.
We have the information for you here.
Great. And the good thing about it is that when you go to one of these technology workshops, they help you with an iPad, with your iPhone, and then five, six people sit together and they have one person that sits right here to help you individually if you need it. That is the beauty of these workshops that ARP is doing. So find out about everything that ARP is doing. But anyway, yes, sir.
You can call 311, City of San Antonio, and they'll tell you
anything you want to know.
Classes, being held, and library.
311.
That's true. 311.
You know where I got it? From the house number on the flyer.
From what?
The number on the flyer.
Oh, really?
Good.
Great.
When I called them there, I said, well, I have another question. And they said, right. I go, I heard about tech classes.
Yeah.
And she goes, yeah. Oh, where?
Okay, we just got some feedback right now that at the senior centers, once you find a senior center, they do also have technology classes. So they have computer classes as well. I think the more classes, free classes you can take, the better. So for those who are interested, this gentleman just offered up that information so that we know that. And they also have other, I know we've been there to talk about Social Security and different things. And so that's a good thing. That's another resource in the community.
The gentleman in the back had his hand
up
first.
Yeah, probably. Hi. My name is Gabe Castillo. I'm with Congressman Lloyd Doggett's office. But I did spend a lot of time, spent 6 years working in the city council office as well. And what the gentleman said is right on. 311 is probably the best way of getting in touch with any of the services, any of the departments within the city of San Antonio. I worked quite extensively with a lot of seniors in the district office as well. And the senior services, the human services department, they have a senior services department, again, that we use essentially even to this day. And they're very helpful. There's a gentleman there who heads it, named Edward Gonzalez. He is perfect. He'll give you a list of all the programs. They'll assign you a caseworker, and if they don't know the answer, they reach out to AARP and to ACOG and different organizations here around the city that can find you the answer just about any senior question that you have.
Do you have a number for that person?
You can reach to 311.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I do have a number, but I just don't have it off the top of my head.
Yeah.
But you can reach to 311. When you call, tell them you'd like to get the number to the Human Services Department, Senior Services Division. And they can give you all kinds of information on the Senior Center, too, by the way, and everything that's going on there, and what kind of services they offer as well.
Yes, sir.
What was his name again?
His name again?
Edward
Gonzalez.
Lady had a question. Yes.
I just wanted to say that one of the greatest resources that I found when I was looking for help with my parents, I took care of both my mother and my father. All of the hospitals have social services departments, and they're like little clearing houses for anything you need.
Great.
Yeah,
thank you for that. Are there any other issues or challenges that you have in your neighborhood? Any ideas that you want to give us?
Yes, ma'am. I have a question.
Yes.
Take care of my aunt, as I mentioned. there any resources for like a traveling nurse or doctor that would come to her home? She's not sick, thank God. She just needs like a blood pressure check. She needs a flu shot.
Does she see a doctor at all?
Yes.
Okay, your doctor may, sometimes in order for her to get the service, it has to be a referral from the doctor.
Yes, I've heard that.
But she's eligible for probably a home care.
A home care.
I just did it. And a visiting nurse also.
I
But it has to be referred by the doctor.
On your next visit, going to take her, then just refer that to them.
Dr. Correa?
Yes.
There is an Austin-based group called Senior Services, and they do a twice-yearly mail-out of all housing available throughout the state, but specifically here in San Antonio.
Oh, really?
And, yeah, and when I was doing social work in different hospitals, that was a wonderful resource. To have phone numbers and names of people.
And it's Senior Services in Austin?
Yeah.
Is it through the city of Austin?
No, it's private.
Separate, okay.
Google it and sign up for their literature, their booklets online.
Thank you. Any problems with security? Any problems with sidewalks? Any problems with
sidewalks?
I realized, you know, we have here where there's a lot of prostitution, drug use, and cemetery.
What district do you live in?
Two.
District 2. I live in District 2. It used to be, of course, she's now the mayor, but we do have a new council member. Have you tried their office?
We've tried to be in touch with Isaac, but nothing ever came of it. We've written letters. It's a different Heights area. Mm-hmm. And we have been told, you know, that it's a coming up area, new artists and things going back in. It's a glorious neighborhood. Well, it stopped at Palmer Street or something. So we never had streets redone. We need curbs. We need sidewalks.
Sidewalks.
And they've not done that. We've just seen a couple
You know, that's an important issue. And one of the things that ARP has done with our volunteers is we've gone out and done some street surveys. We've gone out to check out, because a lot of times you'll see that you know, it's almost impossible to get across the street because the streets are so wide. You know, if you're a little bit older, if you're in a wheelchair or something, I mean, it takes you forever. And by the time you're halfway through, the lights turn and all. So it's really dangerous. Then we've got all these other streets that don't have sidewalks. And the ones that have sidewalks are either cracked or, you know, there's something
missing. Or they're on one side, but they're not on the other side.
Or there's a tree in the middle of the sidewalk. I mean, these
are very
uneven. Yeah, these are all things that are important to our community and things that you as an individual can get involved in doing. You know, as I said, our volunteers have gotten together and they've gone out, they've identified streets and said, you know, this is a street, you know, whatever street, Commerce Street or something is, you know, is really bad. Let's go out and get together. So a group of neighborhood people get together, go out and do a survey saying, look, there's no street lights, there's no sidewalks or anything else. And then you go back to the city council person. And
we have three of those.
Yeah, so and we've had some really good success with that. But that's something that you all can do. Yes, sir.
Yeah, again, we had a meeting with the city. He's right on that. There are some programs with the city that you can get in touch with your city council person where they can put out these signs. You've probably seen there. A perfect one was on Fredericksburg Road. It's called a hawk system. And you know how wide Fredericksburg Road is. Mm-hmm. Well, that hawk system, what it does, it works along with the lights, the city lights, the stoplights that are in between major intersections on a busy street that way. And this is right across, I don't know if y'all are familiar with any of the senior centers here, but there's a senior apartment right there on Fredericksburg Road. Y'all know where the, it's called a Tip Top Cafe is? Okay, there was a couple of incidences there where somebody was run over and a couple were killed and trying to cross. You know how wide that street is? And it's right in the middle of an intersection where people didn't want to walk to the corner and walk over across the crosswalk on either side. So they're taking chances and going darting right across there. What the hawk system does, and this is something that you can ask your city council person, is but in a nutshell, what it does, it allows you to press the light before you cross. And it's a regular street light that's right above it, and it'll turn. It's always on green, but when you press that light, it's on a timer, and it'll turn to red. People stop, and it has sensors on both ends so that once you're across the intersection on the curb, it times out after like about 10, 15 seconds to give you enough time to get on the curb away from the traffic before it turns green again and allows the traffic to go through. That's called a hawk. There's a reason that it's called hawk. It's an acronym for somebody who don't remember what it is. But if you call the city council person here, they can initiate traffic engineering with the city of San Antonio to come out and do studies on that. And then they could push it through very much for you as well. So if you have a situation where you have a street, like Culebra was another one. Culebra Street was a location where a lady got run over and killed. So that's another very wide street, that's very busy as well.
Same thing with Military Drive.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's another one.
Thank you.
But there's also the Department of Transportation is a good resource as well. And they're right there on Callahan. So.
I kind of agree with this lady that, you know, sometimes you do certain things. Unfortunately, trying to get to the right person is always very difficult.
Yes.
And it takes forever and ever and ever, and sometimes you could just give up. Yeah. And I mean, you just get tired and you get frustrated that you're not seeing any results. So that's a big problem.
And nobody else wants to do anything because nothing gets done.
Yes.
There's a new council member in District 2 and he wants to get elected, he's appointed, so now's the time.
That's an opportunity for you.
And that it's a shame to have to do that.
Yeah. Right.
You know, you should be able to say, hey, you know, there's 20, 50 people that we need the same thing. What's the problem?
Well, and I encourage you to document how many times you've actually reached out. Because in a call, you said, you know, I called Tuesday at 10 o'clock, I called Friday at 11:30, I called Monday. That is very powerful.
Yeah,
so if you start documenting, and that's good. And I guess it depends on the responsiveness of that person that has that district. But, you know, those are things that you should document.
You know, take pictures of the cars that are stopping, and that's kind of hard to do.
24/7. Is there a police substation near you?
Yes, there's one at McCree.
Sometimes that helps too. Yeah. Going on terrible. Yeah. She's been there. So they're aware of us, but it just seems like, I don't know,
something
has,
I guess it pushed them out of some area.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, I live over here off of Espada Road. I live like right across, right behind Stinson Airport, at Stinson Airport. My house is up on the hill. Now, my house is right on the corner of Espada National. 2 years ago, it's going on 3 years now, the bridge collapsed. And it's been collapsing. It's been, so now there's a lot of traffic in our area because of that one street. I've called 311. I've spoken to a lot of people. Our neighbors, we've had community meetings through our church. And I've yet to hear when that church is going to get fixed, or I have heard it was because of funding, money's not been able to get the money to fix it. That has caused a big problem, like I said, for traffic in that area now because of that one street being closed. We get a lot of bicyclists that go through there. There's no sidewalks at all. I had heard a year and a half ago that they were going to add sidewalks and they were going to make it the street wider. It's been a year and a half.
And who did you reach out to?
Well, our church, Cabrini, the people that is in the community, we all gather together in their grounds at our church, and we did have a meeting, and it's been like a year and a half. We haven't gotten any feedback on when it was going to get fixed. I called 311, like I said, and have gotten no information.
What district are you in?
I'm on the south side of town, right off of Espada Road in Ashley. I'm inside 410 off of the
south. Probably District 3.
And it's going to be 3 years in July. This July was 2 years, as a matter of fact, that bridge collapsed. The bus route, my daughter would pick her up right in front of the school. Now, everything had to be rerouted. All the kids have to now, their parents have to scrabble to certain area to drop off their kids.
And you're talking about the school bus?
The school bus, yeah. It used to go through there. We have, there wasn't that much traffic. Now it's real congested now.
Is the school district also trying to figure out how, because they would be a very powerful ally.
I'm sure indeed they're.
Well, they had to reroute the buses.
So you would, somebody should, I mean, it sounds like they're organized, you've got a coalition, but you should really reach out to that school district, because they too, I mean, they have, having someone with that particular sort of population of children, and then you've got your church, I mean, having that kind of coalition. I know it's a lot of work, and I know it should be easy. Ideally, we wish we could just call and get it fixed, but that might be another suggestion.
When all else fails, sometimes calling the troubleshooters helps, because they do not want the bad publicity. And I don't know if I can say that, but I'll say it anyway.
And troubleshooter, you mean like?
Media attention. Yes, sir.
I really don't have a question, but if I may, I might add a couple of suggestions. Another number that gets forgotten in the city a lot is 211. That's a very important number for people who need help. Maybe there are people out there who can't pay their utility bill. This line will get you help along that line. You know, there's a lot of resources there. Another thing, too, is crime in the city, as in all cities. But if you want to cut down crime in your city, get to know your neighbors. I moved in Monta Vista almost 17 years ago. We had a lot of problems with late night parties, under drinking, mostly from Trinity. You know, it's not cheap to go there. When people send their kids from out of state, they give them money, they live in that state, do whatever they want to do. Found out the neighbors were a little intimidated, a little afraid of retaliation. I had to, did something about it. I wasn't afraid. I got tired of the police not doing anything, so I got a hold of the coach. He did something about it. We don't have those issues anymore, but we know each other. There's a new online community. It's new here. It's called Nextdoor. It started in California. And what it is an online community for your neighborhood. I started ours for Monta Vista a year ago. And you have to live in the neighborhood to join it. But then you get to see other neighborhoods as well. And we get on there, and it's sort of like Facebook. When there's crime, somebody steals something, a car was broken in, we put it there. If somebody needs a babysitter, we put it there. It's not for commercial. We ban people, you know, selling things, all the garage sales. But we're getting to know people.
It's like little newsletters, except on Facebook, something similar to that?
It's similar to Facebook. It's an online community, but you join it, you put in, you verify that you belong in that community, in that neighborhood, and they're blocked off. If you don't have one in your neighborhood, start one. Just simply go on and ask them to start it once they get the boundaries. But they're growing steadily.
And
how do we
get there? Pretty safe. I mean, internet security.
You first have to verify that you live there. Yeah. I started it. I'm the lead. I didn't know it was going to be the lead. I'm the only one.
De facto.
And I actually put in a credit card to verify my address, and I immediately changed it. I just had my street in there. But by now, people know. Right. And we organize a lot of the National Night Out. We haven't had that in a while. I started it there, and people RSVP. They let you, Halloween, if you're going to give candy, you go on there and say so that the people with their children know that you're giving candy. They can take your house, you know. But there's a lot of resources out there. I've been a volunteer for 8 years, in some capacity. Very involved in the Lions Club. I'm working. So Dover right now. By the way, I'm very lucky to be in another AARP program, SCSEP.
Oh, CSA, yes.
I was recently laid off again in 17 years. So I, you know, they're paying me a small amount to volunteer, basically. And they call it training. I think it's fantastic. We have a lot of resources out there. Those of you afraid of a computer.
AARP is partners with many, many organizations. And one of the organizations that we have, that Alex is the chair of the little council, is what is called SALT, Triad SALT. And that is a partnership between the sheriff in the Bexar County, the police department, and AARP. And what we do is we meet just about every month to talk about the scams and all the crime that's being perpetrated against the senior citizens. For example, this coming Sunday, Bexar County Sheriff Department is holding one of those night outs that you're talking about. And they're going to be holding those all over the county. And the first one that they're doing is this Sunday from 11 to 2, and it's off of I-10. I-10 at Ralph Fair Road. I don't know if some of you have gone out I-10 where there's this place called Mi Casa Tamales. And it's like a gathering place for dances and things like that. And they bring in big country western people to sing. But at the same time, it's a really big place where you can come in and visit with the deputy sheriffs who are going to be there, and then AARP is going to be there also. So we're also in the anti-crime or anti-fraud for against senior citizens. We've got the fraud network. So there's a lot of resources that you can find out in on the internet in our websites. We've got an AARP National, we've got an AARP Texas, we've got an AARP San Antonio. So.
Yeah. And with that, what Gloria was saying, I mean, again, AARP is for 50 plus. So I know a lot of you would never consider yourself to be a senior citizen. My mother, who is 70, doesn't consider herself to be a senior citizen. But point is that we really want perspective. And we really are trying to figure out, you know, what, you know, the 50 plus, you probably want something a little bit different, right? The 50-year-old who just turned 50, first of all, they're like, AARP, you know, you're looking for me, it's a joke, right? And then you have people who are 62, 65 and have experienced and what AARP may be able to do for them, whether it's the Medicare Part B that they hear about because of the membership, whether it's a discount because they saved money, or whether it's because we gave them some information about Social Security that they needed to know, or it's because of our CSEP program, which is a senior community employment program. Depending on it is income qualified, but we're always looking for candidates that we train and we try to place in. We actually try to place them in employment, but there's no guarantee, right? However, there is partnership, and it does, you know, it gives you a small stipend, but it also keeps you busy, because when you're laid off, you want to stay at home, right? But just kind of keep that in mind. So, you know, again, thank you for everything that you're giving us, but if there's anything else, anything that you think needs improvement, or maybe something great that's going on in the city somewhere else that you'd like to see closer to home, we're here. This is all going to go into our plan, so we want to be able to say we came to Mission Library and they told us they want, you already told us some stuff, you know, obviously safety is a huge issue, streets, curbs, some housing, told us a lot. If there's anybody here, even if you don't live on the south side, maybe kind of some of you came sort of southwest, maybe even further, Monte Vista, sort of downtown or north of south of downtown. Yeah, not far from Central Catholic, as my son goes. But anyhow, just, you know, please get the wheels rolling. If you have anything else, we're not trying to bug you. We just want to give, you know, the input.
Do y'all have meetings like this very often, or what do y'all do actually for the in community?
Yeah.
Can we do to have, you know, maybe something like that once a month, every other month, or where everybody kind of gets together and.
Yeah, so, you know, Rita, that's a great question. And we do have what Gloria alluded to, a community council. And the community council does meet on most months, but they take a break during the summer. And then through our volunteers, we do have at least a quarterly meeting for our volunteers to get updated on everything we're trying to do in the city. Our membership, believe it or not, we have 133,000 members in Bexar County, and it's growing. So it's a little hard, but we're trying to figure out how do we take, we used to have what's called chapters, and chapters was a way for people to be engaged. But we've learned through research, boomers do not like chapters. They are, or it's not that they don't like them, they just don't want to do that. And it's kind of overwhelming when you look at the research. However, we don't have to call it a chapter, but we could gather maybe every other month. And maybe we need to do that in different sectors of San Antonio. I mean, those are great thoughts.
Yeah, because sometimes you have, like the doctor just said, you know, we're out there in 10, and, well, most of us are not going to go away.
Right. Yeah.
Well, we'd like something in our community that we can gather and maybe have the same information, but in our community.
The way we can do that is we would love to have a lead. Think about it, no pressure. But like Gloria, she's a lead. Julia is a lead. You know, they're busy. They're doing a lot of stuff. But as y'all are, but if there was a lead here, we could train that person. They could come and maybe they have a little extra time and we could train them. This is what we're doing. Or we can be in contact. And if Joe and I can't be around, maybe we can in different sectors of the city meet on a bi-monthly basis. On a, you know, I don't want to say monthly because monthly is over, you know, it's a lot, but you know, we could, depending on what that person wanted to do. But it's about who wants to gather, who wants to hear about the issues, the updates, what happened with this, what happened with the input, what's going on, what kind of events are out there for us. You know, we're going to be handing out some information shortly about some technology classes that are going on around town.
I nominate this young man right there.
No,
by the way, the GE, I've sent like several people to the GE workshop. I'm from the IT world, and you guys are doing awesome now. They were so impressed.
They're very professional.
Yeah. Very cool.
Really impressed.
Well, we need to bring one, and we're working on bringing one to the south side of town. Right now we have classes at, Joe, you want to tell them where we have our classes at?
We have classes at the Pearl Brewery at the San Antonio Area Foundation. And I think that's the address is 303 Pearl Parkway. And we have those, and we're going to hand out the sheets. We're having them twice a day. The next training is on the 23rd. That's going to be at the Guadalupe Theater. That's at 1301
Guadalupe
Street. Yeah.
And I'm cheating because I'm looking at your flyers. We have flyers, so don't worry, you're going to get that information.
Anyway, these are 2-hour trainings that we do on your smartphones, your pads, iPads, you know, Kindles and all. We provide the smartphone or the pads and all. You come in, you can bring your own so you can say, well, how do I do mine? We'll be able to provide information and go through the class for 2 hours, and then you can come back as many times as you want. And then for next year in 2015, we're going to add on to that. We're going to use different types of devices. Right now we're using Android and Dell devices. Next year we'll be switching them out using Apple devices. But you can bring your own device and have it. We've talked about several things and all, but ARP really, you know, people know us for our magazines, for our discounts and all. But you know, you all don't really know that we really are in the community like we are now. We're in the community doing tech training, that we're in the community doing work on you know, trying to get safe streets, that you know, find issues of financial security. These are all things that are important to you, you know, to our community and all. And these are things that we want to make sure, you know, that you know, we work with you in doing that. Now, we don't want to come in, you know, ARP is a huge organization. You know, we don't want to come in and say, you know what, we know what you need. You need to have this or that. These are called community conversations because we want to hear from the community. We want to work, you know, together with you. You tell us what y'all need and how we can work together in getting that done and all. Okay? ARP, you know, is a huge organization. It, you know, it's one of the most powerful lobbying organizations in the country. Okay? And so, you know, you have us in your neighborhood. We want to be able to work with you and address the issues that you're talking about, safe streets, you know, all those things and all. And so, you know, we're going to be here, you know, on a regular basis. We're trying to open up, you know, an office so we can have, you know, an office space here. We've been working on it for 4 years, to be honest with you. We're that close to getting one. And then y'all can come by our offices and, you know, have a place to come by and visit us. But we are working on that. You know, Lisa and I, you'll have our information, but get online, look at www.arp.org. you know, either San Antonio or Texas, /SA, you can look up and see what's going on in your community. If you want more information, Lisa and I can provide my cell number. I give you my cell number now. It's 512-431-7402. And I'm here to be able to hopefully work with you in meeting some of the things that we need to do. 512-431-7402. We'll be around. We're going to be here. We're holding some other, you know, hoping some other conversations. We're doing some things. We're doing something big at Trader's Village. Lisa, you want to talk about it?
Okay, so to cultural events, Joe and I have been doing what's called listening posts throughout the city around what would you do, and we're actually going to hand out cards soon, so that we want to see if you didn't want to say anything, you know, in the crowd, we would love to get your thoughts. I think there were some pens here.
I think everybody has a card.
A pen. Everybody has a pen.
Okay, but part of what we heard, and we've done about 8 or 9 listening posts, and that's, we were, for example, at Ciclovia. And we asked people, what would you do to make San Antonio an even better place to live? And so people were like, more cultural events, more festivals, more time for family, more fiesta, more Spurs, more. I mean, you heard a gamut of things. But we saw a trend, and the trend was cultural events, parks and open spaces, jobs. That was a big plus. And then you saw housing. Housing starting to become a little bit more popular. And maybe because San Antonio thinks that we have a connection now at the office of HUD, I don't know, but housing is, you know, there's a real need, we know that. There's research that indicates we need affordable housing for as people age. But now, just giving you that context, but also we wanted to tell you that because of cultural events, and we are Hispanic Heritage Month, this is for everyone, because we love everyone. We are going to be having a pretty large event at Trader's Village, and we have invites for you today. At Trader's Village on October 4th, and it's the name of our event is called Celebrando con AARP. From 11 to 2, again, you don't have to write it down because we're going to give it to you. From 11 to 2, we're going to be having what we call a resource fair, and we're going to have a lot of the same folks that you're discussing today. How can I, you know, donate blood? You know, how can I adopt a pet? How do I improve my park? How do I get some dance lessons? Because I want some dance lessons. I want to learn how to salsa. We're actually going to have a dance instructor there, no charge, free to you, that will be teaching you how to dance from 11 to 2. And then we're going to have some entertainment. We're also going to celebrate with music. And the folks that will be playing at this event, after 2 o'clock, we will go with live music. The Trader's Village, to get in, the only charge is $3 for parking. However, if you have your AARP card with you, up to the first 300 cars get in free. So there really is, you know, it could possibly be a free event for you. But the folks that are playing starting at 2 o'clock are the Texas Tone Rangers. They're a little bit of like Tejano country. We have Viela, who's a Chicano blues band. We have La Diferencia playing. We have the Tex-Maniacs, and then Roberto Polito's closing for us. So we have a slew of entertainers. It is free. We want you to come out. You can sit in your lawnchair, enjoy the fresh air. We're praying for fresh air. If you bring your AARP card, we have some goodies for you. We're not going to tell you what it is. It's a secret. You'll have to come. We're going to be under a tent. We're going to have volunteers. It's going to be fun. We don't have enough money for food. However, they do sell food. It's pretty affordable at Trader's Village. I don't know how many of y'all have been out there. But it's a really nice avenue.
I know where it's at. How many people know where Trader's Village is?
We're going to give you the information.
I know where it's at.
Oh, okay. Yeah, well, and the address is here. Trader's Village is actually located at 9-9333 Southwest Loop 410 at Parasol Road. So not far from
that. Not far, yeah.
And it's a huge facility. Mm-hmm. It's traditionally called a flea market, but we're going to be under the Brown Expo, which is a pavilion, and it is a top-notch. For anyone who's ever been there.
A lot of food, kind of like fiesta.
And again, it's fun with a purpose because we're going to have resources from the city there. Joe's been working really, really hard to get those partners there. They're not going to be selling anything. I mean, for the most part, I think we have the Guadalupe there with some of the creative art if you're interested. But other than that, they're there to give you information. And they have goodies for you too. And there's going to be door prizes. Some really nice door prizes you can register for. So, I mean, I'm not saying, I can't tell you.
Something about the Spurs, but I can't tell you what it is.
And then in addition to that, as Joe mentioned, we are working locally. We're working on local discounts. Currently, all our discounts are whatever our national partners are working on, and they're great discounts because we can go, I don't know how many of you know this, but you can go to Outback Steakhouse and get 15% off your bill. Now, they used to do it like all the time, but I understand now it's just Monday and Thursday. I guess too many AARP members were going on the weekends. But locally, we, at the Tumulto Festival, and it only happens once a year, we did have a discount for our members. That was our first one. It was a small one. We're going to kick it up next year, but I'm really proud to say that you'll be hearing soon that we have negotiated a discount package with the San Antonio Spurs for our members to attend. Now, there's select games. However, they're not bad. And you can get a $49 ticket for $25, and that's all I'm going to say until you get your mailer. I'm really excited. We're also going to be the official, we are also, when the season starts, the official sponsor of the Baseline Bucks. A little thing we're doing because we want to connect with people. And golly, Joe and I looked at the research of the Spurs, their audience, 48% of their audience is 50 plus. Mm-hmm. And that's not just who's in the arena, that's who's watching on TV and who's listening to on the radio. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to do some meaningful partnerships that make a difference to our members. And we'll be working on more. I know there's museums and we've had missions and what about this? We're working on more. More to come. We just thought we scored a real big one.
Yeah.
Okay, Gloria wanted to mention something else that we do.
Yes. How many of you have had phone calls or emails where they want to take your money? We have all the time. I'll give you an example. Alex has many nieces and nephews, and he's got two nephews whose names are Junior. So we get this phone call from this kid named Junior, and he says, quiero hablar con mi tío. Mi tío, es Junior. And I said, Alex? He said, yes, tío Alex. Well, then I said, okay, well, let me get him. And so this kid wanted to convince Alex that it was his nephew by the name of Junior. Well, he's got two. But as smart as and sharp as Alex is, he says, wait a minute. You ask him questions and go to find out that it's this some kid that wants money from him because he's in trouble. And so if it can happen to us, it can happen to you. The same thing with me on the computer. You get people that send you emails all the time. And even though you can be intelligent, you can have a doctorate, you can think you know all the stuff that's going on, you don't because they are so good. But and the reason I give you those examples is because AARP has a fraud network again, you have to get on the computer, but it's very, very helpful, and it keeps you updated with whatever is going on, the stuff that's being perpetrated on the seniors. It's just unbelievable. They come to your house, they want your Social Security card, they want your Medicare card, they want to take your money for fixing your roof, and then they take off. And those are the types of things that we talk about in the Song Triad meetings, because of all these things that are going on in the sheriffs. The deputy sheriffs and the police officers, they come and tell us all this stuff that they're doing and trying to keep all this fraud from happening to the seniors. So check out for that fraud network that you have.
There is one that called
Yes.
recently, too.
You owe us $7,000 to her aunt. And scared her.
She said, yeah, she says, why?
Yeah, that's right.
And I could not do that because of unavailable number.
Exactly. Yeah. Unknown number, don't answer it. Yeah. Or private number, don't answer it. That's what I've been telling you.
I think this lady has got the
I'm thing sorry. Though. This lady right here, I'm sorry, go ahead. Did you have your hand up?
No.
No,
she already knew what you were talking about.
Oh,
okay.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sometimes they want to give you $2 million as well.
Oh, yeah. You just have to get on the bank.
Yeah, don't fall for that.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes, ma'am. Well, my mother is 86.
7. And this man came knocking at her door. She lives by herself. And he said that he needed for her, he needed to sit down with her to complete a census, community survey. And it had to be done. And if she didn't do it in 7 days, they arrest her or something. And she got so scared.
Oh, my God. Yeah. And that's what they do. They threaten you. And they make you afraid. And so you give in. And if you have nobody to talk to or ask for advice, then you're there for them to
Okay. We're passing out these sheets, and they may look the same, but they're different. You know, these are all the classes that we're having for, you know, for the rest of this year. They're on the front and back. So we have a couple of classes at Guadalupe and a couple of classes over at the Pearl. So make sure you look at both sides because they're different. So you can see all the classes. All you have to do is you don't have to be an AARP member in order to go to these classes. You just have to call up and reserve your space and go. Bring a friend or something. Just make sure you call and tell them that you're going to have two people or three people.
And do it fast because they're packed. They have only so many seats, and so they get full right away. I think this lady right here had your hand up. It's all right.
That's a senior moment.
Yeah. A mí también se me olvida.
There were three attorneys in the city, and they would do your wills. I don't think we're doing that anymore.
I know that there's legal help in Washington, D.C., but only in that area, in that particular area, because I've been to the building, and they have, you know.
There is an office called the AARP Information Office. If those attorneys are still doing it, they would know. And it's on McCullough, but I don't have the number right now. 3-4-something. Wait a minute.
You know, a couple of other things. We're talking about that. A couple of other things. We talked about the CSEP program for job training. AARP also does, free tax aid service, for your taxes. And we also do driver safety. If you haven't taken the driver safety course, it really is a good course. I've taken it a couple of times, and it really is good.
Twice. If you call that office, they'll tell you where the classes are being held in the city. And they will also, each year they start doing the tax returns around the 1st of February. They're at that office, but you do have to make an appointment.
What office is that?
It's the AARP Information Office on McCullough. And I was in there recently, and they had a room full of people taking the driver safety class.
Yeah, and both driver safety and the tax aid, they both offer classes, not just at the info center, but in the community. And so we can, if you go to arp.org/San Antonio, that will tell you what's going on in the city. So for tax aid, for example, you'll have a variety of locations. We do have, because we partner with some of the nonprofits, and what we'll do is we'll go for, it's a housing nonprofit, we'll go into wherever that apartment complex is, and we'll set up shop, at least the tax aid folks will, and they'll serve the community. Yes, sir.
One thing about the driving, I've for years wanted to take that class, and I've always worked. It's always on a weekend. The minute I got laid off, I went to look into it to go to one. They now have them online. But I'm taking it online. I'm in the middle.
Another thing, you know, another thing we're doing is we're doing movies for grown-ups. You know, these are free movies that we show preview before they come out. You know, we've already done with the Cesar Chavez movie, we did the Cantinflas movie, we did another movie with...
And So It Goes.
And So It Goes.
With Wall Street.
And we're planning to do a couple of more coming out really soon. So, you know, get online, look at, you know, what we're offering.
Yeah. As Joe mentioned, we are looking right now at doing a Movies for Grown-Ups right here at the City Base Theater. We're still in negotiations, but it's an animated movie, though. It's called The Book of Life. But it could be something you're interested in, or maybe you want to bring someone with you that maybe, you know, I think I love animation, but you know, not everybody does, but if you want to bring someone with you that may like it, that'd be great. There'll be information going out on that. So just to kind of keep you abreast. But kind of coming back to the, you know, the age-friendly community planning plan, I know we've heard overwhelmingly that quality of life issues are always a concern, safety, sidewalks, streets, and really, what about the services? You know, how can I get more information on services? How can I have more information on activity? And I guess a lot of these, there's a lot of resources, as the gentleman stated earlier, in the city already, which a lot of us collectively listed, like at the senior centers, they have computer classes. But it's just so hard to find it when it's, you gotta know who's this, you gotta know who's that, you gotta know which website to go to. We're hopeful that our arp.org/San Antonio website will offer you that information. But again, part of the age-friendly communities, part of that feedback is, you know, how do we collect all this information to ensure that people of all ages, but particularly the 50 plus, know where to go? That's always been, no matter what, like community initiative I've ever worked in personally, it's like, how do we warehouse all that? So I don't have to go look, you know, I use a computer somewhat. Well, no, I use it, but.
I have a question about that. Well, a comment about your commercial. One, it's like, I love your commercial, but
you.
When you say I'm here at the mural, like, I don't know where that is.
I know, that's
what
I thought.
Okay. So does anybody know where that was at? Does anybody have any idea?
I have to ask, but now I know.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so
the Guadalupe Cultural Arts Center.
Oh, okay.
It is such a big complex that they have the set of murals both off of Guadalupe Street and off of Brazos. We moved from this set of murals to another set of murals to another set of murals. And then finally we wound up, you know, the La Chiquita? Panaderia, that also has beautiful murals, and it also has the steps printed on how to dance up women and all these things. So that's when they asked me to do that, and I said, are you kidding me? They said, no, you have to do it. So what it's supposed to be, I'm doing a selfie, because I'm going all around and I'm taking a picture of myself. And so they asked me to do that, and as somebody pulled up my favorite polka of all time, and that is Rinconcito en el Cielo.
Yeah.
And I love that. So they pulled it up, and there I go, and I'm starting to dance like this. And that is there on Brazos Street on the sidewalk, and it's La Chiquita Panadería. So we had a lot of fun, but it took from 7 in the morning to about 4:30 in the afternoon. It was a long day.
I was raised around there,
really?
But that stuff wasn't there.
Oh, wasn't there. It's there. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful murals. And so it's just part of our culture. You know, and the mural on the wall of the panaderia, you see La Tejana mural. And you've got, you know, a man and a woman, you know, dancing. They've got the accordion and all those things. And so it's very, very culturally relevant to us, to the Mexican-Americans in our community here in San Antonio. So I really, really enjoyed it. But boy, was I exhausted. And it was hot, and it was in the sun, and it just turned out to be a really, really good effort. I really didn't know what I was getting into when, you know, they asked me to do it, and I said, sure, why not? Got the camera in your face all day.
A lady was talking about the senior visual center, I'm not looking at the senior centers. It started out by building the first one at Bob Ross Senior Center of Babcock. And they was going to, the city planned to open four for each part of the city, the north, the east, the west, and the south. And I think there's one right here in Red Dead that I call it. But anyway, right now, I understand there's seven of them. So they already got their four and three more. And I believe the city is planning on opening more. Since they're very popular.
District.
They have computer classes in them. They have all kinds of
guitar
exercise. Pool tables.
We did join, my sister and I, Emma Austin, on Lamar and Hyde, and I love it. I go like to work, and one day I had a doctor appointment, and I go, I had the doctor appointment, so do you have a note?
That's great.
And I love it, because I just retired like a year and a half. So.
I hate going to those senior centers. Let me tell you why.
Okay, why?
Because I walk in to the Vista Center, I walk in, and these guys that look like they're 200 years old, are lifting weights and everything else, and I'm walking here with my gut, and I'm saying, oh my God. Yeah, but I mean, they're so involved, so busy.
Yeah, they have exercise. I love it. On Thursday, but I didn't feel good, so I didn't go today, but tomorrow, you know, okay.
But good for you.
It's nice. I do like it.
Good. That's good to know that some folks are enjoying that. Okay, any last thoughts? What you would do to make your city an even better city? An even better city to live. Any other thoughts? Okay, we handed out a card, and on that card, I believe it's that hard card that we handed out, we are asking you, in case you didn't give us your feedback, even if you did, we want you to document, how would you make San Antonio an even better place to live for people of all ages? Give us your best thought. Around the border, there are just some like categories just to kind of jog your memory. But if you could give us that feedback, we'd really, really appreciate it, because if we didn't collect your thought here, we want to collect it on this card. And for those of you who didn't check in, if you could please just let us know that you were here, only because we'd love to invite you to our continued activity. We want to make sure that you get the invite for Movies for Grownups, anything we're doing really around the city. But if it's in your neighborhood or it's close to you, we obviously, you know, want to make it convenient. So if you didn't check in, please come up. Don't be shy. So we can just kind of make sure that we want to make sure that we get in contact with you again.
I just wanted to know how did you contact me? I'm not a veteran.
Okay. So
I got an email.
Have you ever? Okay, and that's okay. If you got an email from us, maybe you open one of our emails. Did we email you trying to let you know that you may qualify for the membership, or you might in the future qualify? Yeah, or maybe if you were active doing something for us at Marshall. So
or so.
Yeah, I don't know.
Or it could be a friend who is an ARP member that might have, because sometimes there's cards that say, would you suggest somebody? Or maybe they give you a name. Or we did a lot of, you burned a say, presentations about Social Security and Medicare. I don't know who attended one of those, but we had hundreds and hundreds of people attend those. And you might have filled in something.
Or someone referred you to the other person. So hopefully you didn't mind giving that example. Great. So please, if you didn't check in, please let us know so we can get you signed up. Or at least checked off, I should say. If you hold your cards, Julia will take your card.